Hello everybody and welcome to a very special episode on the Books on Toast channel. We are trying to do something cool and new and unique on IGTV only. It's called Lit Lockdown. So our first guest for this session is the supremely talented and hilariously funny Akash Khurana. Woohoo!
Yay! This is the first. I didn't know this. I'm the first guest. Oh, okay.
First guest of the lit lockdown.
I didn't know this is a new thing. Lockdown khatam hone aa raha hai and now you're starting this lit lockdown.
Who told you this afwah ke lockdown khatam hone wala
hai? Haan, डेढ़ महीना तो हो गया ना, उसमें कितने गेस्ट आ सकते थे?
तो भाई हम कितने मर्जी कर ले, लिट लॉकडाउन तो रोज कर सकते हैं.
हाँ, मर्जी है, नाम अच्छा है, कभी भी कर लो,
है ना. बना के रखेंगे हम, रोज लॉकडाउन कर देंगे.
सही है.
So thank you Akash for joining us and helping us pop our first cherry. So yes. So before we begin, I want to formally introduce you to our Books on Toast viewers. So Akash Khurana is a powder keg of talent. He's a screenwriter, filmmaker, playwright and theater producer. He's responsible for titles such as Krish, Kite, Sarva and web series TVF Tripling. His theater company AK Various Productions has put out notable plays like Dhoomrapan, Internal Affairs and Bayan. He's also an actor and has played the role of the memorable Papa in Ye Meri Family and also Vani Kapoor's Papa in David. So happy to have you here, Akash.
That was anything but a formal introduction.
Yeah, so. Why? What do you mean by that? How else would you like to have you need to give you an award at the end of it?
you were really excited about the introduction, but yeah.
I'm very excited about my introduction I write for the guests on my show. So thank you for coming.
I'm going to use that, huh?
Okay, so. Please. I will message it to you. Don't worry.
Okay.
So Akash, yeah. What we're going to do is essentially talk to you about your reading habits, what kind of books you like to read, what you don't like to read, and basically how you keep up with your reading habits. So I'm going to begin this session by asking the first question we tend to ask everybody who comes and talks to us about books. What are you reading right now, my friend?
I actually just finished a book this morning.
This morning?
Yeah, I was, we were the last time we tried to speak. I was reading Devil in the Kitchen, which is Marco Pierre White's autobiography. Mm-hmm. So I finished that this morning. I did a post about it and I said that I'm going to have a chat with Books on Toast and maybe they're going to help me figure out what I'm reading next.
So, thank you for the plug. I did see that post on your timeline. So tell us a bit more about the book, what you liked about it and what you didn't like about it.
Yeah, I'm not much of a non-fiction reader. And that might actually be answering a question that you were going to ask me later in terms of the stuff that I don't read. I've always been very much a fiction reader. But I think what happened is that with Marco Pierre White, I think because of MasterChef and stuff, and it was just a very interesting personality that you kind of saw. And I think my wife Dilshad picked up this book. My wife is a home baker, among many other things. So she's a home baker and a psychologist. So she does all the nonfiction. She reads a lot of fiction, of course. But so she picked up this book and I was just actually kind of, browsing through our bookshelf when I finished my last book, which was a Nick Hornby book called Funny Girl.
I love that book.
Yeah, I love Nick Hornby. I've read everything. Now with Funny Girl, I've read everything that he has ever written.
So, which is your favorite Nick Hornby?
I'd have to say High Fidelity. I love About a Boy. Once, I mean, the adaptation, the film adaptation was lovely, and all of that. But I think as a read, I also love Juliet Naked very much. But with Nick Hornby, I think what's happened is that like I've been reading him through the last say 10 years, I think that you read like something at a particular time and it just matters to you a lot more than maybe if you revisited it or if you read it before its time. And I think High Fidelity kind of just happened at the right time. High Fidelity kind of happened at this slightly comparatively younger and reckless phase, and perhaps on the cusp of, just thinking about trying to kind of get your life in order and just reflecting about your past relationships. So it kind of just landed at the right time. So I think High Fidelity is the one that really kind of connected with me. I love all his work though. Funny Girl was actually, I had forgotten about it. I had forgotten that I had it. I was very proudly thinking I'd read all his work. And then I found this and I said, oh, this was pending and I didn't read it. So I did. And then when I finished that, I was just looking through the bookshelf and I saw Devil in the Kitchen. And I was like, okay, this is an interesting, let me attempt this. And it was actually quite a good book because, like I said, I don't do too many autobiographies, but this one's a really candid autobiography. I mean, and I think, like from the very first chapter itself, he's kind of not making any apologies for his personality. He is actually saying that I come across as an asshole and that is who I am. Mm. And he gives some of the reasons that he is, but never for sympathy or never for, you know, any kind of like wanting any forgiveness for it. So I really like the fact that it's quite candid and it actually kind of talks about a lot of, and his journey is fascinating. So, Dilshant and I used to watch a lot of MasterChef. So we became kind of MasterChef fans and Marco fans. And then I got a little addicted to Kitchen Nightmares with Gordon Ramsay. And Gordon Ramsay trained under Marco. So it just kind of all kind of made sense and it all kind of came together. And it was a good read. So I don't know now what I'm going to pick up next. I have a bunch of books. I have to confess, for someone who's been a very avid reader all my life, I have never read Murakami. And I'm sorry, Sharon. My wife has read almost everything that Murakami has written. So I might actually venture into my first.
Which one are you trying to pick up?
So I was talking to Dilshad about it and I was asking her what I should kind of, begin with. I think she began with Kafka on the Shore, but she was recommending that I start with Sputnik's Sweetheart.
I completely agree with that. As a Murakami fan, it's the easiest book, it's the shortest book, and plus it's like a full story, it's not like a short story, right? Short stories are very plot-oriented, they'll tell you event, goodbye.
Yeah.
So this one is a bit deeper, but it's not as deep as all other Murakami books. So it like really helps you dip your feet into the waters to see if this, what did you really like.
Yeah, so that's what I was thinking. The thing is, it's just something that, I've read a lot of Ishiguro, and Remains of the Day is one of my favorite. I was thinking, and Dilshad actually has pretty much like, I think about 90% of all of Murakami's books.
Wow.
So I was like,
do you guys read together, Akash? You and Dilshad, do you read together?
We don't. There are days when we land up, we find ourselves sitting on the couch together and both reading.
Really? That's okay.
But it's not something that happens regularly, to be quite honest. It's just something that sometimes we land up kind of finding ourselves next to each other with our books. Also, I think, I think it's just very different kind of times that we kind of take it up. Dilshad also has kind of gradually moved to and accepted the Kindle, which I have not been able to.
You mentioned.
We were talking about that. So, the Kindle, I have a Kindle app on my computer. I use that to kind of go through books that perhaps I want to buy, mostly plays. I read a lot of plays. So, this hashtag 20 in 2020 challenge that's happening is not counting the plays because then I would have crossed 20 in January. But
So plays, are you reading plays more from like a work perspective or do you also read plays for leisure?
I think now it's reached a point where, there's always a little bit of an ulterior motive. The thing is, I don't really buy or pick up plays unless I think that they are interesting enough for me to read with the idea of staging them. If somebody would recommend a play to me and say that this is a great play and you should read it just for the fact that it's a great play, then I would probably read that. But the thing is now with my mindset, it usually works in such a way that the moment I start reading it, I am kind of also reading it a little bit like a producer / director.
Mm-hmm.
What is the potential of this play actually, being staged? So I think that's a completely, there is a little bit of a kind of leaning towards it over there.
So this is interesting, actually. A lot of our guests have never really recommended any plays to be read. So can you recommend some plays for our audience to read?
Yes, I think there'll be a couple. So one play that I think everybody should try and get their hands on and read is an Indian contemporary play which was written by a very close friend of mine called Siddharth Kumar. It is a play called The Interview. It's the first play that he wrote, and I think that it's a play that should be read for contemporary. And again, it's easy. I'm not sure. See, the thing is, it would be very easy for me to turn around and say everybody should read Othello, but I'm not. Those are the obvious choices. I think that Siddharth has written a fantastic play called The Interview. Adhir Bhatt has written a wonderful Hindi play called Dhumrapan. I've had the privilege of staging both of these plays. There is a play called Baghdad Wedding written by Hasan Abdul Razak. It is my go-to play. When anyone asks me, because it is just a fantastic piece of writing. And again, I had the privilege of being able to direct that play. So you will find a lot of recommendations coming from like things that I have loved enough to want to do. So for example, yeah.
One find a play to read? Like, where do you find all this?
Oh, they're all on, you have Kindle editions of everything.
Okay.
All the plays are available in Kindle editions. Unfortunately, bookstores in Bombay are very badly stocked.
Yeah, that's plays. True.
The only place that you would actually find maybe a slightly better than usual collection would be the Prithvi Bookshop. And I think what happens is that within the theater fraternity, a lot of us land up, you know, borrowing plays from each other's libraries because we all actually have very good libraries of plays. There is another play that is a slightly older play, which I think that, you know, people should also read because, you know, sometimes people find it a bit, the format a bit difficult. But there's a play by Ira Levin called Veronica's Room, which is a four-person thriller. And it's a fantastic thriller, Veronica's Room. I think everyone should read Veronica's Room if they can get their hands on it. And of course, the classics are all great. I mean, no one can stop talking about Shakespeare and the like. But I think it takes a little bit of getting into to read Shakespeare.
Yeah. Yeah,
if you're not somebody from the theater. So yeah, that's why the plays that I'm talking about are plays that I feel are so accessible. I think both Dhoomrapan and Interview are available online, so it's an easy.
Okay, these are really good recommendations. So actually, I want to reel back a little bit. You vaguely mentioned that you were doing your Instagram 20 in 2020 challenge. So tell us about it. What prompted you to start the challenge, and what awesome books have you read and discovered because of it?
So the thing is, Dilshad, my wife, started this challenge actually.
Oh, acha. Okay.
It was just something that she did for a lark, and then it kind of caught on. The thing is, I have been actually, I from childhood have been reading a lot, and then in the middle when I was kind of directing a film and a web series, which would be about say maybe 2 years, 3 years ago, I was reading a lot less.
This is Karma and Tripling, right?
Yeah, when I was doing Hijack and Karma and that I was doing, and I kind of was reading a lot less. And, you know, I was spending a lot of time at work and I was reading a lot less. And then, you know, the thing is that even those little, you know, windows where I would normally read, I was just taking the easy way out and watching something on Netflix, you know, and doing that. And I kind of let go a little bit of the, I let go of the reading habit a little bit, and I was never very happy about it. So about 3 years ago, 2.5, 3 years ago, I kind of started this getting back into it. And I would kind of post stuff on Instagram calling it my hashtag reading resolution. Where I was trying to read even while I was traveling, and you know, I went back to reading on flights because it was, you know, like instead of just being on your phone and not like watching something and, you know, downloading episodes of Bosch or playing Candy Crush, and I was like that, no, I think, you know, you should just read a little bit. And then I kind of started doing that, and then I think that at some point of time even Dilshad had the same feeling, though she's always been kind of in touch, but then she was like, I want to read a lot more this year, so I'm going to do 20 in 2020, and she kind of put it up. And then before we knew it, like I think on the first day itself, about six people kind of said, hey, I'm in, I want to do this too, I want to do this too. And then we all kind of got into it. And then, you know, degrees of separation increased, and more people started getting involved and sharing books. And that, I think, was the best thing. Like, I mean, Dilshad has a friend called Chrisel who has very different reading habits. And there's this girl who I'm neck to neck with right now called Insia Leswala. She's at Inses, I-N-S-E-S. She has some fantastic, you know, a fantastic reading habit, and she keeps posting the most interesting books. And now it's reached a point where we actually kind of take each other's recommendations. So that's how it started, really. And I mean, the thing is, I don't always remember, so I'll have to go back to Instagram to figure out what I did read.
Yeah, we can all stalk Akarsh on Instagram. So you guys actually watching this video, you please must start following Akarsh to get a lot of book recommendations. Plus, behind the scenes gossip from a lot of the things that he does. Yes, go on.
So, but offhand, if I talk about like the last 3 years and like books that have really made like, you know, an impression. I would say, I read a fantastic book called The Leftovers by Tom Perrotta, which now I believe is I know it's an HBO show. It's a show on Hotstar, which I haven't seen yet. Because I genuinely love the book very much.
What is it about?
Very interestingly, it is about a random incident that happens one day where 2% of the population vanishes. So it's really about the rest of the population who have stayed back, who have lost this, you know, one person that they kind of knew. and how they are coping, and also the whole problem as the neighbors have not actually lost anyone, and they're still in a very kind of happy frame of mind. Mm-hmm. And about people, how they are dealing with this loss that suddenly happened, you know, where people kind of just disappeared one day. And and it's a fantastic book. It's just so that was one great book that I read.
That's a great recommendation. I'm gonna get
You should read The Left. Tom Perrott has written some other very good books also. There's a lovely book called I think it's called The Wishbones, which I read very long ago, which is about a rock band. But Tom Perrott is good, and I discovered this. It's almost like it feels like young adult fiction, but it's not, because it's a lot deeper. Sally Rooney. I read Sally Rooney. No. I know Sally Rooney is the new big thing. I haven't read Normal People. I've read Conversation with Friends. There's an author called Tommy Wallach, Wallach, and I read two books of Tommy Wallach, and one of them was called We All Looked Up, and again it was actually the story of all these teenagers in a high school who are coping with the information that a comet is going to strike the planet in the next like 21 days. So it's really about the last days of their lives in that sense.
You like a lot of dystopian fiction. I can see that.
The thing is, it's a pattern that might be emerging. So I'm also Nick Hornby, which is not dystopian at all. There's a couple of these lovely books that I have read, which have this kind of slightly darker, you know, almost like apocalyptic kind of vibe. Mm-hmm. And I like those very much. But I read pretty much everything. I have a lot of favorites. So I'm actually also not. And another great book. I'm sorry. I know you don't want to talk about too many books. The last one I'll mention.
Is
this fantastic book that I read when I was traveling last year, called How to Stop Time by Matt Haig.
I have read this book also.
Nice. And I've bought another book by Matt Haig called The Humans, but I haven't read it yet.
Matt Haig has written a lot of really interesting books. His this one non-fiction book, sorry, yeah.
The Reasons to Stay Alive.
Yeah, that was also like, reading. I read that. Read that last month. It was quite nice.
Yes, because Matt Haig, I think, came very close to taking his own life at one point of time.
Yes.
Owing to depression, and then got out of it. We have Reasons to Be Alive somewhere as well. And I think that's one of Dilshad's purchases, because she's also a psychologist. So,
Of course. That's helpful.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, it's difficult to pick out books that you love like that, but I'm just talking about stuff that I remember from the recent reads.
Yeah. What do you think of Sally Rooney? Because she's a very hot author. Like, everybody talks about Normal People, of course. It's being turned into an adaptation as well. I wonder what you think about it.
I did not read Normal People. I read Conversations with Friends. Mm-hmm. I liked it. I didn't love it.
Yeah, same. I'm on the fence with her work.
I'm very much on the fence. I like that there's a tapping into some probably serious realism in the characters. Yeah. I think that, for example, I think she writes her women very well, and real. But is it an entertaining read? I don't think so. Was there something greatly new that I was offered in the plot? No. So it gets a bit, not indulgence, the wrong word. It just gets a bit, repetitive certainly, but it also gets a bit it's just flowing along. It's not really doing anything.
There's no resolution that's happening. You're just like, going along with the title.
That's what I felt about Conversations with Friends.
Yeah.
I recommended it very strongly to a friend who I felt like, she was like one of the girls in the book, and I told her that she must read it.
Yeah. Who is this person? Do we know her?
I mean, considering that character is not the most positive, I'm not going to take her name. So
fine, we'll have to just stalk your Instagram and figure this one out. Who else will do it with me? Okay, fine. So speaking of this, do you think Conversations with Friends could make for an interesting play if made a little tighter?
Personally, if I was the one who had to kind of be backing it, I don't think it has anything new to offer in terms of its story.
I think
it's really weird. Like, in how like in books I do non-fiction very rarely. Mm-hmm. In theater, I'm somebody who doesn't do like abstract theater at all. I do theater that needs to have a narrative. So I'm I'd like to fancy myself as a storyteller. Mm-hmm. And for me, the story that I bring has to be something that offers something, at least either unique or a new take on something. Mm-hmm. Now, for examples, in terms of conversations with friends, in terms of, you know, relationships between the two roommates, or a relationship with a married man, or an equation with an older person. I've seen all of this. I mean, for me, it didn't break any new ground in terms of mm-hmm. telling me there's a lovely language to it, and perhaps that's why it's a great, it's a loved book, mm-hmm. because Sally Rooney certainly has a new voice. Mm-hmm. But does that voice translate into something that I want to see on stage? Perhaps not for me. So,
Fair enough. So speaking of, I mean, let's talk about the things that you adapted. You adapted Kite Runner. Last year
I didn't adapt it. It was already adapted. Okay. The thing is, adapting a book to stage, quite honestly, is quite a massive task. And I think it's quite a difficult task. And if Kite Runner was offered to me on a platter saying that this is the novel and please make a play out of it, I probably would not have had the balls to do it. But I happened to
adapted script.
I found a script by an American professor called Matthew Spangler.
Yeah.
And I found the ready script, and I picked it up purely out of curiosity, because I was like, how have they adapted the book into a play? Like, you know, how is it humanly possible?
Yeah.
And then I was very happy to read that, you know, that there was this was done in tandem with Khalid Hosseini. It had the author's blessing, which is always a good sign. And I read it, and I thought it was a good adaptation. I mean, I think there are certain problems with adapting Kite Runner to stage, because it's very... verbose in that sense. Like, there's a lot of, you know, the narrator having to describe things that are happening, you know, rather than being able to show what was happening. But I still thought that it was a very smart adaptation, and that's why I took it on. We've done a lot of book adaptations, but books that were already adapted, like Tuesdays with Maury, we found a play script. We've done Rebecca, by Daphne du Maurier. We've done Enid Blyton's Mystery of the Pantomime Cat. We also briefly did an adaptation of a couple of Tintin comics.
Really?
We did that. But that we adapted ourselves. That was kind of like an amalgamation of Prisoners of the Sun and Seven Crystal Balls.
Wow, that sounds so cool. Okay. Do you still stage these productions or no?
Tintin shut down. Kite Runner's done 10 shows, but Kite Runner's a very expensive play to run.
The production level is quite crazy.
Rebecca did a bunch of shows. Tuesdays with Maury did about 31 shows. I don't think any of the shows that are running right now are book adaptations. I think now the stuff that's running is more of our contemporary original stuff. Really.
So then this begs the question, if you're a creator, and you did say that, you know, you sometimes read plays with the eye of a producer. So what makes for, like, do you look at books and think, okay, this could make for a good adaptation? Like, what do you look for in a book that could make it fertile for being adapted for screen or stage?
Firstly, I don't look for it.
Yeah, but if it comes to you.
Yeah, so the thing is that the couple of times that it has happened, it has, you know, while reading it, it has been like, oh, this would make a fantastic film, you know, for example. And I think I was talking to you about it the last time where I read this terrific book called The Little Coffee Shop of Kabul. By an author called Deborah Rodriguez. And when I read it, I was just... I have a slightly inexplicable affinity for the Middle East. I tend to be drawn towards stories from the Middle East. I think because emotionally they kind of resonate with us, because culturally they're not, you know, that far apart from us. It's not the West; it is the Middle East. You know, it's the there is that, and also there's a slight exotic nature to the surroundings. And I also feel that a lot of their stories actually stem from conflict. So the conflict is inherent. They don't have to look for conflict.
Yeah.
You know? So, like, I mean, one of the other books that I completely love, and I think I had tweeted about it, is a book called Escape from Baghdad, which is a book by Saad Hussein. It is the most hilarious book I have read. It is actually about these three misfits who are kind of trying to get out of Baghdad in war-torn times. And it is the most hilarious book I have read, you know, about like story and strife. But so the thing is that when I read Little Coffee Shop of Kabul, it immediately struck out to me, because It's actually set, of course, in a coffee shop, which is run by an American woman in Kabul. And it's about the stories of these five or six women who kind of assemble over there, and that coffee shop becomes a part of their lives. And while I was reading it, I felt that, you know, this had so much potential to be a film or a series or even a, you know, a play, but of course a film or a series because it's so cinematic in its nature. And I loved it. I absolutely and loved it so much that I actually kind of reached out to the author. And she was very receptive. She was very excited that someone from India had kind of reached out and said that they were interested in making it. And then I kind of, you know, sent her a link to my film Karma, and I said, these are my credentials, and, you know, so that you know that I'm not just some like floozy that's talking to you. And she was very gracious and she responded. And I mean, she was very open to having a dialogue about it. But then the next step is a really complicated one, because then you need to kind of, you know, bring on someone who's a producer and who can have a certain amount of capital, because, you know, to even option the rights, you need a certain amount of money to kind of lay it down. And it gets into, in, you know, organizational kind of logistics. But it's something that I still, it's on my wish list. It's something I definitely want to try and do. So, yeah.
Well, you guys heard it here first. If it does turn into an adaptation, you can give us all the credit. We will help you, Akash. We will pray for you. First, I think everybody should read this book. Can you tell us
or someone, again? Or someone else could read it and want to make it before me, and then I'm screwed. So.
No, I don't. I think you'll be the first one. I have a feeling. Mm-hmm. If you found like the humor in it, then I think you'll only make it. Okay, cool. So, okay, fine. I actually wanted to... Okay, so then in that case, tell me a book adaptation that you thought was brilliant or maybe even better than the book.
You mean a film?
A film or a series or even a play, anything.
Wow, this is a tough one.
Yeah, it is very tough.
Because there's so many, right? And
I thought very hard about this question before asking you.
I think About a Boy was a great adaptation.
I think that was a sensational adaptation.
We spoke about it. I think that was a great adaptation.
Godfather.
The Godfather. Yeah.
You know, this, I hated the book as much as I loved the movie. I really didn't like the book.
Hate the book. I liked the book, but I thought that just was wow.
Yeah. That was really wow.
That's a great adaptation. About a Boy is a great adaptation. Offhand now, I don't know which other ones that I love.
Have you seen The Watchmen?
Yes, I have, but I never read the graphic novel.
Oh, okay.
I actually haven't really gotten into graphic novels.
Huh.
Again, that playwright, Siddharth Kumar, that I was talking about, he's a complete graphic novel junkie. And he's been trying to gift me graphic novels, which I don't land up reading.
He's trying to gift you, meaning he's been trying to gift you, not accepting it. That is very sad.
No. I have actually. He actually gifted us one. There's something called Blankets that he gifted us, which is supposed to be very good. Okay. But I haven't read. Maybe that could be the next one I read. I don't know. Let's see.
So, have you seen or read Lord of the Rings?
I have watched the films. I have not read the books.
Okay. That is again, like in my opinion, again, like a great adaptation, but a really boring book. Like very slow.
There might be people who will put out like a hit on you. I know people.
Or will they come and put a ring on my finger and I will go mad? If that was going to happen, it's okay.
You have a ring on your finger.
I could get another one. Who is checking?
Okay. Wow.
Okay. Cool. So I think this is really cool. What I'm going to do now is. Throw some rapid fire questions at you and you'll have to tell me the first book that comes to your mind. So don't think too much about it.
Should
what? Show us your bookshelf. Is it in the same room that you're sitting in?
We have about four bookshelves. There are some books behind there. I don't know if you can see them.
That's a nice caricature of you.
Yeah, those are books that we haven't read yet. So those are there.
Oh, nice.
I'll have to move my monitor and I don't know if you'll see it. So, yeah, there's one.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. Nice.
And we've got the big bookshelves in the hall. So,
Do you also have more books in your house than people and things? I mean, that is obvious.
We are only two people in the house. So, yeah, it's very easy to have more than that. A lot of my books have been given to the Crew Club.
Yes, which we do have. Yes.
which you spend a lot of time in. And I was very happy to see that they're lying there and they're actually in a good condition. And I was very actually happy to see that at one of the rehearsals, I saw a couple of people actually pick up those books and they were planning to read them and put them back. And I thought that was great. I was really happy.
Yeah, we do that a lot design. With all the books. We let people pick it up and, you know, take their time reading and return it back. Or they can also swap it with another book. They can take one home and give us another one.
That is a great thing. I mean, that's a great thing that used to happen in the West a lot, and now it happens here, and it's lovely.
Yeah, I know. All our readers need to stick together.
Forrest Gump, great film on a good book. So Forrest Gump was a great adaptation.
Forrest Gump, I've not read the book at all.
I've read the book and I've seen the film. Yeah. Great adaptation. Yeah.
I really like the movie for sure. It was one of those iconic movies that I grew up watching, so it sort of stayed with me for a really long time. Okay. So, Sukesh, are you ready? Are you ready for your bookish rapid fire five? It's only five questions. Yeah. Don't worry.
Okay.
But just be honest and the first thing that comes to your mind. So, a popular book or series you really regret reading?
Sorry?
A popular book or series of books that you really regret reading?
Shit. I don't regret reading anything. I think that's a horrible question. Why would I regret reading anything?
I mean, sometimes you read shit and then years later you're like, oh, what? Why did I read that?
No, I don't think any reading can waste my time like that. Yeah, that's a very bad question from Books on Toast.
Come on.
I'm going to dodge that question completely and take an ethical stand and say, how can you say that any book would be like you regret reading a book, you know?
Has it never happened to you, like, as a guilty pleasure, you pick up something popular and you're like, but what say, and then years later, like, nahi padni chahiye thi.
Oh, I will tell you, wait, there is a book, there was this book called The Mughal by some Indian writer.
Oh, the, William Dalrymple.
No, not that one, The Mughal, it's like one of these courtroom fiction things.
Oh.
The Mughal, somebody had sent it to me for like considering it as for an adaptation.
Yeah.
I regretted reading that. Yeah. that wasted my time. Yeah.
I think all Hindutva people some people who might be following this or watching this must be very happy with you. So good job.
It was The Mughal, like, you know, the business magnate. It wasn't like The Mughal.
Oh, The Mughal. Oh.
The Mughal. That was a waste of time. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so this is a very easy question. What is the one book you can't stop rereading?
High Fidelity.
Great choice.
Nick Hornby, yeah.
I think even I can read, I've read it maybe two times, I can read it again. Maybe I'll pick that up now again. So, thank you. Okay, the next one is also very easy. Who is the author, living or dead, you'd like to hang out with?
Stephen King.
Yeah, why?
A very important part of my growing up years. I another author who I've read everything by, and including nonfiction stuff like On Writing.
That's a really good book, right? Like, a lot of people recommend that as a great craft.
Yeah, it's a very good book also because the man had a very difficult and fantastic journey. I think whatever I've read of his interviews and stuff like that, he seems like actually like a really twisted but fun guy. I think he would be very interesting to hang with. And I've read a lot of his stuff. The thing is, it's a big joke in the house. My wife really likes horror films, but I'm a puttu. I cannot watch any. And the only horror that I have actually enjoyed in my life is Stephen King horror. So for me, obviously, there's something special over there. But yeah, Stephen King, I'd like to hang with Stephen King.
Do you have a favorite Stephen King? I mean, a horrible question, but there must be one that, you know, really sticks out. Like, I'm a big Stephen King fan. Like, I love Green Mile. I love all his books. But The Green Mile, for me, was a great book, also a great adaptation.
Again, very difficult. I have quite a few favorites.
I'm sure. But anyone.
But I'd say Pet Sematary.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's damn scary, yeah.
Pet Sematary and Carrie, of course.
Carrie. So it's iconic for many reasons. But listen, that's a very difficult book to even get through. Like, Pet Sematary is very scary. So,
but, his books were not something that ever kind of... in fact, there was a time where only people used to only gift me Stephen King books because they knew that that's the one thing that I lap up completely. So, in fact, I think my copy of The Shining made it to Cuckoo Club. So,
hey, have you read The Outsider? That was the last book that he put out, no?
The last one, no, then I don't think I've read that. I think the newer stuff, the last thing I read was, there was a sequel to Mr. Mercedes that he wrote, which I read. I remember that. I forget the title, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, slightly controversial question next. Who is the author you'd give anything to have a romantic liaison with?
Wow. Shit, now I'm going to sound really bad because I'm trying to think of all the female authors that I read.
That is very bad. Coming from you, Akash, the man behind the Ek Pehen and Bayan.
I do. I swear to God, I do. I just, you know, I mean, like offhand, like, you know, like, even, because I suddenly realized that even while I was talking to you, you were talking about all these male authors. And then you spoke about Sally Rooney. And then I said not so nice things about her.
Yeah, what is this?
Yeah, the sexist behavior.
Yes.
Who would I like to, what author would I like to hang out with?
Not hang out, have a romantic liaison.
Oh, romantic, yeah. Say, suggest some women, no?
J.K. Rowling.
No.
Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie.
I have to read one book by her, which Insia recommended, but no, I don't
know. Which one? Americana.
Yeah, is that the one? Is it good?
It is brilliant.
Yeah, she was recommending that to me, yeah. Then keep saying.
Sally Rooney is one, of course. Margaret Atwood.
Difficult. So Sally Rooney seems like she's a troubled chick. So, like that.
Sophie Kinsella.
There was a phase where that might have been interesting. There was a phase in my life where perhaps that would have been tempting. I think I've outgrown that phase now.
That is a good thing to know, though.
Yeah.
Okay, then, I think we'll accept your Sophie Kinsella concession.
No, don't accept it. It's not valid. No? Wait. Okay, I'll keep thinking. You can move on and I'll keep thinking.
Okay, fine. Okay. So I just have one last question. Which is the one book on your TBR list you can't wait to read? I'm sure you have plenty and I know that you're reading Murakami next, but...
What is the one book that?
That is on your TBR list that you can't wait to read.
I'm thinking actually there are a couple because I left some books. There is a book that someone recently recommended to me and I am dying to read it. And she has promised to gift it to me. It is a book called Shakespeare in Kabul. So it has my love for theater and it has my love for the Middle East. Shakespeare in Kabul is about this group of actors that's trying to put up a play in Afghanistan. That is a book that I'm dying to read because somebody recommended to me and then I read up about it and I was really excited. I just can't wait. And then I kind of said, you know, should I just buy it? Should I just read it? And like, they were like, no, just chill out. Like when this thing ends, we will give you our copy and then you can have it.
I'm getting it on Kindle today now that you've put it in my head. It sounds like something even I will love.
Yeah. So, no, but Kindle edition is not available also. That happened. Yeah? I did that checking. There's a paperback out of stock, but this friend of mine has promised that she's going to give me her copy. The moment we can actually see each other.
Who is this friend? Maybe I also know this friend.
Satvika, you know Satvika?
Yeah, I think I do.
Sudeep knows Satvika well. I don't know if you met her. Yeah.
I think I met her.
Nora Ephron. I will have a relationship with Nora Ephron. Though she might be dead.
Yeah, I think she's... that's fine. We can always try.
That's fine. Necrophilia. Nora Ephron, yes.
But why Nora Ephron?
Because and the thing is, not only the screenplays, I also read a couple of books of hers. There's something that the most serious situations were looked upon with humor. And that's something that I kind of like to do in life as well. And there was a wonderful sense of romance there. And there was also this lovely way of looking at pain, but looking at it, tackling it with humor.
Yeah. I also think that she was the last real good filmmaker who really knew how to make good romantic comedy, like from Hollywood, right? Like, I don't think after her anybody's made anything good that I can watch. And some of her movies I can watch over and over again.
I think Richard Curtis is brilliant.
Yeah?
I like everything that he does. But there was again, it's a phase. Like, see, I don't know, like, does... Yeah. Sleepless in Seattle, it's aged well, but You've Got Mail, I'm not sure. So, you know.
I can watch You've Got Mail even now, like 10,000 times. Because I remember, like, when we just got cable, the same movie used to play in a 12-hour window. So I used to wait till the 12 hours would get over and watch You've Got Mail all over again. Like that.
And You've Got Mail has bookshops in it, so that's also helpful.
The book around the corner. But even Julia and Julia, I think, was a fantastic film. Very nicely created. Bewitched, I quite like. Anyway.
And and there is a the couple of other things. There's actually a lovely British show called Black Books, and I think that everybody who loves books should see that show.
Okay.
It's not on any platform. You'll probably have to do something illegal. I have DVDs, but I won't be lending. It is about a bookshop and about a man who runs a bookshop. And
really?
I was reading a book called Diary of a Bookseller recently, and the author Sean Bittle of that said that most bookstore owners are really crabby because most bookstore customers are really idiotic. So So, but Black Books is really funny, and people should see that.
Noted. I think that's a great recommendation. Also, that's a great way to sort of end our lovely chat. Thank you so much, Akash, for spending your what is this today? Friday afternoon, talking about books to us during a lit lockdown day. So, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
For you guys, please follow Akash on AK Various on Instagram, and also his other channel called AK Various Live, where he does some really interesting storytelling sessions and plays that you would normally see when and if we ever come out of this lockdown. You could actually see them in physical venues, but till then you can actually enjoy the play online.
So should we do a collaboration where you read plays and then you come on AK Various Live and talk about them?
Yeah, okay, that's great.
Yeah.
I'm quite cool with that. Yeah, that'll be fun.
So, yeah, you need to kind of read up on some plays, and once you have some to talk about, why don't you come and then you can talk about them.
Okay, this is great homework for me.
I'll send you the three plays that I recommended.
Okay, please send me those three plays that you recommended, actually.
Then they're related to my company also, because we produced all of them. So then you can come and talk about them.
Yeah, great. Yeah, nepotism is amazing. I love it. Okay.
Amazing.
Okay, thank you, Akash. Hope you have a good day.
Thank you, Sharon.
And I hope you enjoy Murakami too. Let us know what you thought of it. Okay.
Yes, but next week. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. Bye.